The final item of business is members' business debate on motion 23592 in the name of Sarah Boyack on interlinked fire and smoke alarm systems. And this debate will be concluded without any questions being put. Would those members who wish to speak in the debate please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Sarah Boyack to open the debate for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I am disappointed that I have to bring this member's debate today. Disappointed because I know that fire and smoke alarms are absolutely vital to keep people safe, and because the impetus to put together this change in legislation came in response to Grenfell. But following the passage of the SSI, we've not seen the leadership and drive needed to ensure that people are aware of what they need to do now. And across the country, people found out about this legislation after an advertising leaflet for new smoke and fire alarms was issued bearing the Scottish Government's logo through their letterboxes. Then more found out about it through the newspapers with the discussions that followed. But in a survey of their members, Age Scotland found that 34% of the respondents to a questionnaire had only heard about the plan changes through that questionnaire. And if we asked people more generally, I think we'd know that many people are still not aware of what they're meant to do in their homes. And at our committee today, we discussed the Minister's proposal to delay the implementation of these regulations by a year. But I am still seriously concerned that 1 year is simply not going to be enough time to ensure that homeowners are informed of the changes they need to make. And we need the Scottish Government to work harder to put in place the financial package for those who can't afford the changes and a better set of guidance to make sure consumers aren't ripped off. I'm also concerned that we're still in the middle of the pandemic and people have concerns about their safety. Many, many are suffering the economic consequences of the pandemic and money's tight. And it was put very well by one of the respondents to Age Scotland's questionnaire. Everyone will be wanting to get this done and you will not be able to get this completed in time for the deadline, and some people will not have the money to do it in such a short time. In the letter to our committee last week, the Minister said that while the legislation doesn't place a direct obligation on homeowners, it will be up to homeowners to ensure the standard is met. But the obligation lies with our local authorities. And I'm quoting him now. He said, as local authorities are required to have a strategy for ensuring compliance with a tolerable standard within a reasonable period, they have a wide range of discretionary powers to assist homeowners and, where necessary and appropriate, to require owners to carry out work to improve substandard homes. And I firmly believe that as we emerge from the pandemic, our councils are going to be dealing with a range of urgent challenges. So we need a commitment from the Scottish Government that any support in terms of financial or staffing support that councils are providing do need to be supported by the government. We've got ongoing issues about local government funding. But in discussing the post-Grenfell era, we need to make sure that we've got a comprehensive government-led response. And that's the case here too. I want to raise the issue of insurance because it's also important. In evidence to the committee in 2018, the Minister said that in general, it's for individual insurers to decide how they respond to the new standard. Insurers tend to ask whether the property is fitted with working smoke alarms rather than questions about specific standards. But evidence we reviewed at the committee from a homeowner today was concerned with the rollout of these changes. And he was concerned that it's extremely difficult to find information in the public domain about how the insurance industry is currently handling the tolerable standard, especially now that this legislation is in place. So my view that is that given the challenges we've seen with post-Grenfell style cladding and the ESW1 forms, we need stronger assurance from the government that they're working not just with homeowners to be able to install this kit, but they also need to make sure that homeowners are not left with compromised buildings insurance if their building doesn't meet the tolerable standard for the purpose of fire alarms. Now, I want to briefly raise the issue of costs, because at present, the quotes received by Age Scotland members have ranged between £152 and £400. And they've pointed out that for someone on a state pension, £200 is a lot of money to access. And the same will undoubtedly apply to those whose work situation has been negatively impacted by the pandemic. So I'm very keen for the Minister to be able to use his summing up speech today to talk about the work he's done with local authorities, the work he's been done to look at this average of £200, which we're told it will cost. Because we need to make sure that vulnerable homeowners are not being charged excessive amounts. And for many, it's not the simple DIY process it looks like. If you're accessing ceilings, that will not be possible or straightforward for older people, people with disabilities, or folk in tenements. So we need to make sure the support's in place. And I'm very keen to hear the government's full proposals, albeit probably not today. The minister gave us a promise on this morning, but we need a full awareness-raising campaign. My motion called for a 2-year delay at least, because I was concerned about the reality of the implications of the pandemic and the fact that we've not really started yet. So we need not just a publicity campaign, but a coordinated strategy with political leadership to make sure that we get the focus and action that we've not had to date. So I hope that we will get agreement across the chamber that we need to radically step up implementation here. The minister didn't answer my question this morning to say how many houses have still to get the right alarms installed. Because it's not having an alarm that's critical, it's having the right alarm, the interlinked alarm, the fire and smoke alarms, and possibly the CO2 alarms as well. And being interlinked is crucial. I actually decided that before I stood up tonight, I would have sorted my own house. And I went, I read the government's guidance, I read the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service site, I made my notes, as you would expect somebody like me to do. I went to a major store and, armed with all the information I had, I asked for help. I checked it out and I asked for the fire alarm expert in the store. That person came and talked to me. And after about 20 minutes, I went home empty-handed because they could not tell me which of the alarms were actually compliant with the Scottish Government's advice. So there's government action, but there's also a big issue about retailers, installers, general awareness of people, and to make sure that, in addition to supporting the local authorities' work, groups like Citizens Advice Scotland, Age Concern, all those groups that can give people advice, they need to be able to give the right advice on what it is you need to install. And we need to see work with suppliers and retailers, because it's simply not currently clear what is compliant. And that needs to be both in stores and also online. Because I did check out online. It wasn't my first option because I wanted to go to my local store. It wasn't clear online either. So I hope we are not here this time next year. I hope we get a big push on this, because I think we're 6 months to the elections and we've got a long way to come out of the pandemic. There's a real urgency here that is required from the government. We need a clear plan. Our constituents need that leadership. They need effective guidance and support. And I hope the debate we have today helps build that case for action, helps build awareness, and make sure that we are not here in a year's time saying, please, can we extend this by another year? This needs to be sorted and it needs leadership and action. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Move on to the open debate. Speeches of 4 minutes, please. Kenneth Gibson, followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I congratulate Sarah Boyack for lodging this motion and securing a debate on a topic which concerns so many of my constituents. I also thank Age Scotland for providing such an excellent briefing. We remember the shock felt when in June 2017 a severe fire tragically killed 72 people inside London's Grenfell Tower. The establishment of a ministerial working group on building and fire safety in response was therefore very welcome, its aim being to oversee building and fire safety frameworks, regulations, guidance and other relevant matters to ensure people are safe in Scotland's buildings. As a direct result, in January 2019, this Parliament agreed that from February next year, new standards in line with those for the private rented sector should be in place to better protect people in Scotland's 1.5 million owner-occupied homes from the potentially devastating impact of fire. We agreed that all homeowners should install an interlinked fire and smoke alarm system alongside carbon monoxide protection. Of course, nobody anticipated the global pandemic, which has completely dominated our lives since. It's therefore unsurprising that many felt anxious and confused last October when they received a commercial fire safety firm's leaflet which wrongly used the Scottish Government's logo to urge them to make the necessary changes before the February deadline. Like other members, I was contacted by numerous constituents, including residents from a large retirement housing complex, rightly worried about the prospect of having tradespeople enter their homes during the pandemic. I immediately contacted Housing Minister Kevin Stewart, MSP. A listening minister, I commend Mr Stewart for deciding swiftly that he would seek a 1-year postponement of the February 2021 deadline. I also welcome over £15 million of loan funding made available for social landlords to procure and install the necessary alarms to ensure social tenants are safe in their homes. and for providing an additional £870,000 in each of the last 2 years to the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to support home safety visits to vulnerable and high-risk people. Nonetheless, there are several remaining concerns about the proposed new February 2022 deadline that we must address. Given the impact of the ongoing pandemic, I believe the deadline should be extended to 2023. Although the COVID vaccination programme gives us hope, we simply don't know when we will return to something like normality. A 2023 deadline would give homeowners across Scotland clarity and the Scottish Government sufficient time to launch a high-profile awareness campaign aimed at improving understanding of the new standards and concise advice on approved devices and where they can be purchased. Such a campaign is vital to ensure that people are aware of new guidelines to protect their homes. And in fact, as Sarah Boyack touched on, a recent Age Scotland survey showed that only a minority of people are actually aware of the rule change and 73% have not yet taken action. I also urge the government to revisit the financial support currently available to homeowners and potentially provide a more significant package for those who cannot afford to implement the improved standards. I'm sure the government will appreciate the original estimated cost of £220 to make these changes in an average three-bedroom flat is a significant sum for most people in normal times, let alone a global recession. And of course, many people have different sized houses which could cost significantly more. I further ask the Scottish Government to review the price of purchasing and fitting the required Interlinked system so people have a more realistic benchmark regarding the costs these changes to their homes might incur. This would reduce the risk of people falling victim to scams and excessive prices from installers who might be approved yet could potentially overcharge. More time would also allow for the training of more installers, of whom I doubt there is a surfeit. And of course, if there's a shortage of such installers, then no doubt that in itself will force prices up. Presiding Officer, I remain fully supportive of the new standards. However, the current context of a global pandemic requires a further postponement of the deadline while delivering additional financial support for those who would otherwise struggle to afford the installation of a necessary interlinked alarm system. Thank you.
Graeme Simpson, then Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I also thank Sarah Boyack for bringing this debate to the Chamber? We've probably got it the wrong way round. The debate probably should have happened before the committee session today, but it was a delight to take part in that committee session and rejoin briefly the Local Government Committee. And what a shame my good friend Mr. Gibson couldn't be there at the time, but it's always good to hear him speak in the Chamber. Unfortunately, I'll have to apologise that I will be leaving after my own contribution, so I won't get to hear Alexander Stewart. What a shame that is. Now, Sarah Boyack touched on what for me is a vital issue for consumers, people who are actually going to have to go out and buy these products. But because, as she said, she tried to do it today. I myself have attempted to buy the same products with no success either. It's really, really confusing. And it appears they're just not available, not that I could find in the shops. So that needs to be sorted out. In 2018, when it came before the committee, when I was on the committee, I raised a number of very serious questions with the minister. I put them in writing. He responded. Those questions still remain, one of which was around insurance. And what happens if your house doesn't comply with these regulations? I think insurers could use that to wriggle out, frankly, of paying insurance claims. And that is a real danger for people. They could unwittingly not be complying with the law and suddenly find that they fall foul of their insurance policy. That's a serious matter, and that needs to be addressed by the government. It needs to be addressed in regulations, and it hasn't been, frankly. There was confusion earlier today when I questioned the minister about who these regulations actually apply to. On the one hand, they're directed at homeowners. On the other hand, the minister in his letter to the committee says they apply to councils, it's up to councils to make sure these regulations are complied with. So who actually has to do it? It's very, very unclear. There is a danger of rip-offs, of people being scammed. That's still there. I would also question the actual units that are required in these regulations. If you choose to do work yourself and not bring in an electrician to hardwire your house, if you just choose to buy a battery-operated system, which you could do, it has to be A, interlinked, but B, they have to be sealed units. You cannot replace the batteries. So when the batteries go, you have to chuck the whole thing out. That doesn't seem to me to be particularly environmentally friendly, and it could be extremely costly. Maybe you'll have to throw the whole system out if it's all interlinked. I don't think the minister has properly thought things through on this. And that's why it's essential, I think, that even at this late stage, yes, I certainly will.
Claire Adamson.
Very carefully to the members' concerns. I thank him for taking the intervention. But we do not recognise that one of the problems with fire alarms in the past is that people took the batteries out of them. And part of the reason why we want to seal units is to prevent any interference with it operating as intended, which is to save lives in the event of a fire.
Graeme Simpson.
I do take that point. People do take the batteries out. There is a danger here, though, that people just chuck the whole unit out and not replace it if they couldn't afford it. I think it needs to be properly thought through. If you're going to have a system, if you go to the trouble of putting a system in your home, then I think you're going to make sure the batteries work. And I personally would much rather have a system that I could replace batteries and just get new batteries and not have to go out and fork potentially more than £200 to get a brand new system. So I think it would have been better if the minister, and he could still do it, even at this late stage, agreed to delay this by potentially another year. We need to get this right. It's really important. I think it's important that we do this, but it needs to be got right, and we need to bring the public with us. Thank you.
Emma Harper, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate and congratulate Sarah Boyack on securing it. From the outset, I want to put on the record my condolences to all the victims, their families and friends of the tragic Grenfell Tower disaster in 2017. Grenfell has undoubtedly been the catalyst for governments across the UK to improve the law in relation to building materials and fire alarm systems to prevent such a tragedy from ever occurring again. Presiding Officer, I was contacted by constituents on October the 13th and a local elected member, Councillor Ian Howie, who had received leaflets stating that they must update their fire alarms by February 2021, that's February next year, as time is running out for homeowners to make these changes in compliance with the new legislation. Given these representations and combined with the COVID-19 pandemic, I immediately called on the Scottish Government via written question to delay the implementation of the new Scottish Fire and Safety Regulations. I'm sure other members acted too. Those who contacted me were also rightly concerned over having to carry out these changes during the COVID-19 pandemic, particularly as many would require tradespeople to enter their properties, which could lead to exposure to COVID-19 infection. These new regulations, which came under an amendment to the Housing Scotland Act 1987, require all homeowners in Scotland to ensure their properties have a smoke alarm in the living room and in circulation spaces such as hallways and landings, a heat alarm in every kitchen, all alarms ceiling mounted and interlinked, and a carbon monoxide alarm where there are fixed combustion appliances such as boilers and wood burners. With an estimated cost of £220 per home, that was an average estimation. And as we've heard, there's been a range of costs stated by Sarah Boyack in her opening remarks. While I welcome the Scottish Government's agreed to delay the deadline to February 2022, providing time for constituents to make arrangements to have the necessary changes carried out. I do share the concerns of organisations such as Age Scotland over the course of the scheme, and I thank them for their information that they provided ahead of the debate. As a general principle, the Scottish Government states that homeowners are responsible for the cost of ongoing work needed to protect and preserve their own property in line with legislation. Therefore, as with other housing standards, it will be the responsibility of the homeowner to meet the new fire and smoke and carbon monoxide alarm standards. I understand that local authorities have broad discretionary powers to provide advice and assistance to homeowners with work needed to look after their own homes. However, I would join calls for the Scottish Government to issue guidance and further financial support to those who most need it if they are to make these changes to be compliant with the law. And I echo what Kenneth Gibson said, that the Scottish Government has made over £50 million of loan funding available for social landlords to ensure that social tenants are safe in their own homes. And there's been funding of £870,000 has been made for the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service to support home safety visits that ensure that vulnerable and high-risk people can get the necessary alarms installed at no cost to them so that they are safe in their own homes. I've listened to Sarah Boyack's experience of attempting to purchase the right Interlinked system, and it sounds like that was quite a challenge. So it would be interesting to hear how that could be made easier. And Kenneth Gibson also made a good point about helping to protect people against scams. That is something that we probably really need to be aware of. Finally, Presiding Officer, constituents across D&G have expressed concern over the communication of these changes. Indeed, that leaflet through their door is the first they'd ever heard of it. So I would ask the Minister whether the method of communicating such changes could be improved to ensure wider public awareness for this process to take place. So once again, I thank Sarah Boyack and I welcome the debate and the Scottish Government's actions to delay the implementation of the changes to the fire systems in Scotland. Thank you.
Pauline McNeill, followed by Sandra White.
Firstly, thanks to Sarah Boyack, as other members have said, who's brought this important debate to the Chamber, because there's no doubt that it caused stress and worry amongst our constituents, and we've all been contacted by them. And it's probably one of the biggest consumer issues there has been in recent times. But I agree with others, what happened at Grenfell was a horrific tragedy, which sadly could have been avoided. So it's absolutely right that the government has sought to bring in legislation to make people safer. And that said, there are a number of urgent issues with the new regulations that need to be sorted out, and particularly surrounding public awareness of the regulations and costs. Scotland has around 1.5 million home owner-occupier homes which are impacted by the new rules, as well as just under a million homes in the social rented sector. The legislation brings these properties into line with existing regulations in the private rented sector, has been mentioned. Alarms can either be mains or battery powered. There was in a Scottish Government impact assessment that assumed the cost would be around £330 if it was installed by a tradesperson, but it could be much more. And the Scottish Government had initially estimated it would be around £220 per household. And it's one of the issues for me that I wonder how much thought was given by the Scottish Government regards the implications of some families and many individuals who will be unable to afford that amount of money to spend. So there needs to be urgent clarity over costs so that people have a more realistic guide for the price that they expect to spend when they choose to install the alarms themselves, and they need to try a tradesperson for a job. I tend to agree with Emma Harper and Kenny Gibson that perhaps, given we're in the middle of a pandemic too, and of course there's appraising needs to keep people safe, but 2023 to me sounds like a more realistic target year. £220 is a significant cost for most households, for many households, and many people will struggle to afford it, particularly in the wake of the pandemic where people have been furloughed or lost their jobs. Currently, we have 150,000 pensioners who live in relative poverty. And as we know, one in four households in Scotland still live in fuel poverty. These households will simply be unable to meet the new regulations without some financial support. And Sarah Boyack talks particularly about the scams and the leaflet itself which give the impression that this was endured by the Scottish Government, which is extremely worrying that this could happen. The government also needs to provide clear advice on approved devices and where they can be bought. And it also helps people avoiding these kind of scams where inflated pricing from rogue traders has been an issue in the past in other areas. Research done for Age Scotland and Age UK found that more than two-fifths of older people in Scotland and over 400,000 people believe that they've been targeted by scammers. So it is a big issue for this Parliament in relation to this issue. And concerns have been raised of an upsurge in people being targeted in their homes during the coronavirus restrictions. Brian Sloan, Chief Executive of Age Scotland, said, "It is disgusting that anyone would try to take advantage of older people at this time, but sadly, there will always be heartless scammers who prey on the most vulnerable in our society. Older people are already the most targeted group for fraud and scams, and this can have a devastating impact on victims. So not only can they lose a lot of money, but they also may lose confidence and feel embarrassed to confide in their family and their friends. So the Scottish Government must be alert to the fact that scammers are likely to take advantage of new nationwide regulations and must put robust measures in place to protect people from scams and rogue traders. Age Scotland say that it was a one-year delay to the implementation of the regulations is not enough and that the local government committee voted against the delay for the same reason. But it's clear far greater practical and financial support needs to be put in place for older, disabled and low-income homeowners to be able to comply with new regulations, and I think there'll be other families in there who may need some financial assistance. Finally, while it's laudable the Scottish Government sought to improve the safety standards, and I think we all agree on that, more has to be done to make sure that we can achieve both the objectives of keeping people safe in their own homes, but also making sure the costs are not costs that people cannot meet and that they're able to go and purchase alarms which they can put safely in their homes and feel that they're put in by tradesperson, they feel confident inviting into their homes, make sure they don't have any repeats of issues such as Grenfell ever again. Thank you very much.
Sandra White, followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank and congratulate Sarah Boyack for bringing forward this, I believe, a very, very important debate. I'm not on the Local Government Committee, but I've sat in some of the sessions, particularly in the preceding the Grenfell tragedy, which we know that this piece of legislation has come out of, as has cladding as well, which still also has to be looked at the issue of cladding too in certain blocks of houses. It's a very important piece of legislation, but I do believe and agree with Sarah Boyack and others that we really need to extend it for at least another year, particularly because obviously COVID, and I acknowledge the fact that the working group which the Minister set up after the Grenfell tragedy has looked at various aspects of obviously smoke alarms and sprinklers, and I also acknowledge the fact that we have scammers and we had these leaflets going out, but nobody really knew anything about it, and it did seem to come as a not just a surprise but a great shock to my constituents and others, but also to housing associations and local authorities as well. Now that's been well rehearsed in committee and also in this debate. I want to move on to where do we go from now? And as I said previously, I think we do have to delay this for at least another year. Like others, I think there must have been a rush on smoke alarms and sprinklers in various shops. But I needed a new smoke alarm and I got someone in to fit it. And at the time, we spoke about joining the sprinkler system, etc., smoke alarms together. But the tradesman which I had got in, like others, could not access the equipment to join it all together. So I think that is one of the things that, as others have said, we need clarification on that aspect of it. We also need clarification on the cost of smoke alarms and sprinklers. We know it's for the benefit and the safety of the individual households, and also people, well, obviously my constituency, as in others, there is a great number of tenemental properties. And recently, unfortunately, in some parts of Glasgow, we have seen fires occur. not necessarily tragic consequences, but tragic that the fact that the people have had to be moved out of their houses. And recently, just in my area in York Hill, this happened with a tragic consequence, unfortunately, and people had to be put up in hotels. So we know it's for the safety of the people, but we need an advertising campaign, as has been mentioned before, why this is needed, desperately needed, to protect people, and why the government will delay it for another year simply because we have the COVID in the middle of this particular aspect. And as Alice had said, lots of people, particularly the elderly, wouldn't open their doors to anyone to fit these, and it might even happen, you know, in a further year or 2 years down the line as well. So an advertising campaign is paramount to get the message across of why it's so important. But there's the monetary part of it as well, obviously. There's insurance, which has also been mentioned. But I had meetings with my local housing associations, and I know that the government has given funds towards that, but they're concerned about proposed new build, which they've just managed. And in my constituency, it's very difficult to get new build, to buy the land and start to build. But Party Housing Association in particular have managed to do that in three areas. But they are concerned that they won't have enough time to fit the dual aspects of the smoke alarm and the sprinklers, etc. So they're concerned about that, and they would ask that it be extended at least for another year. And I note it mentions housing associations, so I would hope that, that they would fit in along with the homeowners. But just a plea to the Minister, I know the amount of work that's been done in the working group is doing a good job, I believe, but we do need an extension. It's going to cost a lot of money. People don't have it. Pauline McNeill mentioned it, furlough and not having jobs. People are not necessarily able to put forward that amount of money at this moment in time. So I would plead with the Minister in the summing up to confirm that it will be moved another year, and an advertising campaign brought on board. And if we could actually know how many people are able to fit these alarms, it could be a job creation, young apprenticeship, whatever it may be for electricians. But it's desperately needed that people know about it, and plenty of warning, plenty of advance, that they're able to, one, afford it, and housing associations and local authorities can afford it also. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
The last contribution in the open debates from Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm very grateful for the opportunity to take part, and I'd like to thank and congratulate Sarah Boyack for bringing this members' business debate to the Chamber this evening. We on this side of the Chamber are fully supportive of the measures that are coming into place. We completely understand the aims, which are to protect homeowners and tenants by increasing the levels of fire safety in homes across Scotland, and ensure that everyone in Scotland has the same level of protection, whether in their own home or a rented home. However, it has become increasingly evident that the baton had been dropped by the Scottish Government in making people aware of this legislation. I'd like to acknowledge the fact that earlier today, the Minister did accept that this had caused anxiety and distress to many individuals. Most of my constituents became aware, as others have indicated, when they had the warning leaflets that dropped through from a private electronic constructor dropping through their letterboxes, indicating that the deadline was in February 2021. By reading these, residents all over Scotland had initially been given less than 4 months to install alarms at a cost of around £200. It also emerged that failing to fall in line with some of the results for insurance policies could have had a massive impact in invalidating some potential insurance claims. The majority, especially the elderly, were extremely anxious, Deputy Presiding Officer, compounded understandably by the existing coronavirus worries. And during the COVID-19 pandemic, especially the tightening of restrictions of individuals entering other people's home, the additional questions raised about that and the affordability were very much to the fore. And in addition to that, there was also the controversy surrounding the company whose leafleting campaign was used with a Scottish Government logo, and we found out that it did not receive ministerial approval. So that document going through doors that gave individuals the opportunity to see that it was supported by the government, we now find that was not the case. So there are many questions that have to be asked. And we also know that local authorities have a priority in dealing with this, but it also comes at a cost. So, and councils are facing the knife edge with funding situations at present. It's also asking councils to implement some of these. So I think that it's vitally important that we do look at an extension. And I also understand that the time that it ensures that the fire safety takes place. And at the moment, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service have temporarily stopped most of their home fire visits due to the high pandemic issue, but they are still supporting people in high risk. The service also talks about, and that has a knock-on effect to ensure that these safety procedures are moving forward. But the suspension of these themselves creates a backlog, so that has to be looked at as well. But also this, in this whole process, Deputy Presiding Officer, Aid Scotland highlighted a number of areas that they called for some action. They identified the significant package of financial support that may be required. They also talked about making sure that there was clear advice about devices. And we've heard already tonight that some members here have tried to purchase devices and found that quite difficult or challenging. They also highlighted the possibility of rogue traders and scammers inflating prices to ensure that vulnerable people. So all of these have to be taken into account. And as we've already said, there's a major issue potentially with insurance. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, Sarah Boyack moved at committee today that a year was simply not enough time to have this put forward. Unfortunately, it did not win the division, which I supported. But the Minister gave assurances today about the entire process and that he would keep the committee and Parliament updated on developments and advise them of the publicity campaign that was required and is required. Because, as I've said before, we need to ensure that people understand what they need to do. They need to understand what kind of device is required, and they need to understand that it will come at a cost. So we will be monitoring and watching the situation as it goes forward and holding the Scottish Government to account to ensure that these actions do take place. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I now call Kevin Stewart to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I noticed you put 7 minutes there, unlike my last member's debate response, which was 14 minutes. That's what happens when you do it in the back bedroom and there's not a clock. I apologise for that. I welcome...
Can I interrupt you, Minister? I think we all enjoyed it very much.
Thank you. I welcome the opportunity to respond to Sarah Boyack's motion today and congratulate her for securing this debate, although, as Graeme Simpson pointed out, it's maybe the wrong way round in terms of the debate that we had this morning. And I don't want to go on too much around about that debate this morning, but I would draw folks' attention to the official report on that, and I would repeat the fact that I apologise for the way that some of this has been dealt with, largely due to the pandemic period, but also because of that leaflet that Sandra White described as a great shock to her constituents when it came through the door. I have to say, Presiding Officer, it came as a great shock to me as well, and that's not the way that that should have been handled at all. I'm grateful for all the members' contributions today. There's been a lot of points raised. I'll probably not be able to cover them all, but I'm more than willing to respond to people separately. I wrote to all members on the 20th of October to highlight that given the impact of COVID-19, I intended to seek Parliament's approval to postpone change by a year to allow additional time for people. This morning, the Local Government and Communities Committee discussed and approved the necessary regulations to do that. I am very pleased to hear all members today mention Grenfell. And a lot of the work that we've been doing on fire and building safety is in response to that tragedy and the fact that so many lost their lives. We are in a better situation in terms of building standards here in Scotland than those elsewhere. However, none of us can be complacent, and this is an issue where we should all work together to get it right. And I'm very, very, very grateful to David Stewart for cooperating with the government and ensuring other fire safety standards around about suppression systems coming into play very soon in the next Parliament. The new standard is clear, Presiding Officer. One alarm in the principal living room, one in each circulation space, and a heat alarm in the kitchen. Alarms must be interlinked and can either be all mains powered or sealed, lifelong battery operated. Now, Mr. Simpson mentioned that there would be a situation where you may have to get rid of systems because of batteries running out. That would not be the reason for replacing the interlinked battery systems. The point is not batteries expiring or wearing down in those, it is the lifespan of the sensor unit in that, and I'm willing to provide folk with more on that if they so wish, if they want to drop me a note. Having an interlinked system means you will be alerted immediately, regardless of the room in which the alarm is triggered, increasing the chance to escape. The standard also requires carbon monoxide alarms, but these do not need to be interlinked with the fire alarms. As Claire mentioned in her intervention, we have had problems in the past with no interlinking. We've had problems with folk taking out batteries, and this is in response to that situation. That has often in itself led to tragedy, which none of us want to see. Good information is important, and we discussed that at the committee today at some length. And some of the information that has been provided thus far, we will need to bump up. There's absolutely no doubt about that, and I assured the committee that we would continue to let them know exactly how we are going to progress in terms of marketing. We have also engaged with, officials have engaged with retailers and suppliers around about these issues too. Ms Boyack may want to talk to me later around about the company that she went to, because maybe we can do a wee bit of work with them to help them along the way. We want to ensure that we are helpful to retailers in terms of websites, but also in terms of point of sale marking. And I know that some retailers have already got home packs or bundles which simplify the purchase of these alarms which meet the standard for homeowners. And one company is also offering an interest-free payment instalment option to enable purchasers to spread the cost of alarms over a four-monthly period. I don't want to mention the names of the companies here because I might be accused of advertising, but again, if members want that information, I'm more than happy to provide that.
The Minister take
it out. I certainly will.
Maurice Corey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask a question about this business? And Graham, my colleague Graham Simpson raised it. The question of the batteries, the lifelong batteries. Now, how long is a lifelong battery? Well, we don't know. They tend to vary. Would it be possible to make in the technical spec those batteries to be rechargeable? In other words, that you could recharge them in place of installation rather than having to take them down. There would be some mechanism that they could be, like we do, we recharge our mobile phones and things.
Kevin Stewart.
Didn't make myself clear around about replacing units after a point. It is not the batteries that are the problem. It is sensor wear out is the problem. Now, I will check to see if it is possible at any point to replace sensors. But I don't have that information to hand. So the battery issue is not the problem here, it is the sensor issue, and that sensor is, of course, at the heart of how the system works, so that has to be absolutely right.
I can allow the time. Maurice Corey.
I think it's important to actually have that facility as well, if possible, apart from the sensor.
I've heard what Mr. Corey has said, and we can look back at that. But the main point of this is not a battery point, it is a sensor point, and I think that I have to be very clear on that. As I highlighted to the committee this morning, we have also made sure that people can get advice on the type of alarms that will meet the standard, although we don't recommend specific brands. from our own website and through the information provided by the SFRS. And if folk have any suggestions about how to improve that, I'm more than happy to listen to what they have to say and act accordingly. I recognise the crucial role that SFRS have in messaging around fire safety, and we'll continue to work with them to ensure we're maximising opportunities to raise awareness, get good information out there, and signpost to sources of help and advice. And of course, as has been pointed out by Mr. Gibson and Ms. Harper and others, the government has provided funding to SFRS, the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service, around about this, and we're in discussion about how much further we can go. Obviously, the Fire and Rescue Service are dealing with the most vulnerable people, and that is important that we manage to get all the right help to them. And Ms. McNeill, I think it was, mentioned in her contribution around about the fact that some folks may not be able to pay, and she specifically mentioned those folks who are in fuel poverty. As part of our fuel poverty schemes, we can actually have a situation whereby, as well as upgrading heating systems, etc., our contractor there can also supply fire and smoke alarms. Presiding Officer, we will ensure that there is the correct marketing campaign. I'm always open to suggestions around about that. The delay that we have agreed today will give people a further 12 months to install the required alarms. I hope that most people will recognise its safety benefits and take action much sooner than that. And I've instructed my officials to explore all avenues to ensure this is as easy as possible for people to do. It is regrettable that the government was not able to take forward its planned awareness-raising activity this year. Although we progressed some activity and there were plans to ramp up publicity and communications on the run-up to the original deadline, COVID-19 and the associated public health information restricted the opportunities for specific fire safety advice from the government. I absolutely agree that there will be a need for a significant awareness-raising campaign, and I wish to ensure members that that is a clear priority for us. I pledged this morning that I would continue to keep the committee up to speed with all that is going on. We will do that. My final point is an appeal to all members, Presiding Officer, to use your good offices to continue to keep folk in your constituency appraised of developments here and to pass on what we have agreed here in Parliament today. Thank you.
That concludes the debate, and this meeting is closed.